folks of surrounding Tippecanoe Valley counties. My name is Jonathan Engel, and I represent the Political and Economic Studies class at Tippecanoe Valley. Our class now understands the importance of being an informed voter. And we would like to thank the candidates for of the Tippecanoe Valley School Board and the willingness of our Tippecanoe Valley to put this on and help support us fund the renting of this building. I'd like to introduce Mr. Lukens, who is going to be giving the bios of the candidates tonight. So thank you. Mr. Hoffman, if you'd like to come up and speak for us, please.
This is a little messed up there, but it worked.
Thanks for coming, everyone. When I heard that the class was going to put on this forum, I thought, what a better time that parents and community members come together, maybe to share some of the school's challenges and some of their winnings, as I put it, sort of the state of the school corporation. The school corporations in our area, all in Indiana, are having struggles financially, and I've got some of the history and why this is happening that might shed some light on that. Back in 2007, our governor asked for a group of volunteers to get together, a committee, if you'd say, to get together and create a restructured government in Indiana that would bring efficiency and effectiveness of operations and lower the cost for Hoosier taxpayers. This was a seven-member group, and they come up with a title of streamlining local government. After they met quite a few times, they come up with about 27 specific recommendations for local government, but four of them was for the school side of things. At that time, they recognized that school districts, to achieve a minimum school population of 2,000, established state standards and a community-based plan process similar to that established in 1959 legislation. At this time, more than half the school districts in Indiana had fewer than 2,000 students. 46 districts had fewer than 1,000 students. Upon the release of this report, it became apparent that the government wanted to, and a larger amount of supporters, favored shutting down many of the small rural schools in the area. This caused an immediate firestorm to the area communities of those schools, and after a while, the committee, seeing that this is not going to work, people are outraged about being able to shut down these small schools, So they backed it down to schools less than 1,000 students. Well, as things progressed from that, it continued to get worse. The firestorm continued. Folks did not want to lose their small rural schools. So they just dropped the whole idea at that point. However, it doesn't end there. In 2009, the state then took over the general funds of all schools, and they, at that point, taxes paid or filled the general fund. But what they changed was now your taxes went to the state and they give us our money per child to pay for our general fund, to pay for day-to-day operations that it takes to make the schools work. What, as any time, it seems like when the government takes over ish, you know, situations like that. There was they didn't start appropriating the money correctly to each school. Larger schools maybe got more money, smaller schools got less, or vice versa, but that each school did not receive the same amount of money. So what it has done, it seems like as we go on, it just keeps creating less and less money coming from the state for our students and to take them through school. What we're concerned about now, though, is now it's getting to the point that some of the small schools, the Tritons, the Arguses, the Culvers, they are getting so less funds that now they are not able to operate anymore. And what that does, that concerns us, because we know that when they fail, who is next on the chopping block? It's the, you know, right now they're looking at the schools with 1,000 or less students. Well, then they'll be looking at the next step of the schools, 2,000 and less students. So it's real concerning to us that when we have the chance to talk to our legislators, our area representatives, that we share with them how important it is to keep our local schools vibrant. Another concern or another hurt that is hurting the public schools is the price tag that taxpayers for the voucher program in Indiana, which was started back, I believe, in 2000, and cost of the program, I believe, 2013. The voucher program started out as a good thought from the state, offering religious groups, smaller schools to break away from public schools and have smaller settings. And it was originally to lower cost of students, because at that point, when it was first set up, it was made to where the parent had to pay for his child to go to school. Well, then they brought out the voucher program in 2013. And, but what they've done was they changed the eligibility rules in 2013 on the voucher program. And as of today, well, back in 2013, the number of children that was enrolled in private or in private schools was 9,100. At a savings to you and I, the taxpayer, of about $4 million. Today, the problem is, now that the voucher program has expanded, now there is, in the state of Indiana, 32,000 students going to private schools at a cost to the taxpayer, or to a cost to the taxpayer, but a funds pulled away from public schools of $53 million a year. It's just another draw from the public schools of being able to offer what we need to offer. So it's getting real interesting as we continue to lose funds, how they expect us to run these schools. Coming back to our corporation and others around, the next issue we've had is our declining enrollment. I've seen that as one of the questions for tonight. I've done some research, and going back to 2003, up to 2007, our enrollment at Tippy Valley was pretty well steady. Then 2007, 2008, 2009, the recession sort of hit. From that point until today, we have been in declining enrollment. You know, I've done a little more research on that. It wasn't us losing students to other schools, because we lose as many as we gain. So that's pretty much a wash. It's just, I believe, families moving out of the rural districts and moving into more urban. But the way the funding is, as we lose those families, it cuts our funding down more and more. So I just, real quickly, I figured from 2003 to 2016, we are taking care of 286 less students a year than what we was back in 2003, which the figures actually show $1.7 million a year less we are making than what we was back in 2003. So it is just a real concern that I thought, you know, you folks ought to hear some of the challenges that we are dealing with financially. I stopped and chatted with Mr. Boss this morning. We did, I asked him to get a sheet made up of our House of Representatives folks, our Indiana State Senate folks. He got something wrote up for us that will be back there in the back that you can pick up. But it sure doesn't hurt to send an email, you know, saying, you know, we really want to keep our small schools and to be thinking of the children instead of funds all the time. But that'll be back in the back to pick up. On TVS school corporation side, we stand very solid. Our commitment to student success is the strongest it's ever been. As our school corporation has had, or as other school corporations have had to lay off teachers, personnel, because of budget restraints, TVS is actually expanding opportunities for our students. One of the opportunities, such as the farm to fork, It's a new program that we're starting that allows our students to actually raise the food that will be served in the cafeterias and area farmers that are willing fruits, vegetables, meats. We're starting actually the raising the livestock at the school now. We've started the building project, and so that's I'm excited. The soccer field complex is an awesome new adventure out there. I was pleasantly surprised how many kids come out for soccer. I actually got to go out and watch a couple of games. There's times that you can watch paint dry and it can be more exciting, but then there's times that you're about ready to hop off that bench and go out and help them get that ball. So, but that's been a real an awesome achievement. Expanding our ag program, FFA program, we're hoping for more hands-on opportunities. We're wanting to try and get some more of that in back into the school. We're always adding new one-on-one technology. We are adding more dual credit courses, helping these children get more credits in high school for college. We just, I think it was last meeting, we okayed an expansion of our workout facility out there. It's going to be larger than ever. Set up with all the treadmills and everything, public's more than welcome to use. We're adding more preschool classes all the time, as some of the other area schools has closed their preschool systems. We see a need in this community to offer it to help families take care of their little ones. I don't know if any of you had a chance to go out and see the new press box. It is awesome. We thank the Middlers for helping us in getting that built. So just a few things. The Akron school's coming along real well, but it's just a few things that I felt that, you know, you don't hear this stuff out in the community every day. It's a concern to the board. It's a concern that should be a concern to all of us. When you get out and get a chance to see an area representative or a senator or something, let them know that we want to keep a small school strong and vibrant. So with that, I'll turn it back over to Jonathan and appreciate your time.
Thank you, Mr. Hoffman. Well, folks, I got my mess up out of the way for the night, so let's continue on schedule. We're going to have two candidates running for two positions. As voters, you will be able to vote for two candidates, one seat. You will be able to choose between Adam Heckman, Stephanie Overby, and Matt Smith. The second seat will be filled by either David O'Brien, Aaron Zolman, or Tyler Bowes. All voters in our corporation will be able to vote for candidates to fill both seats. Tonight's forum will consist of a series of six questions in which the candidates will have a time of 2 minutes to answer. The questions will be answered by our moderator, Rita Price. Rita, thank you for coming tonight. To maintain fairness and impartiality, the order in which the candidates respond to those questions will rotate throughout the forum. Halfway through, at approximately 8 o'clock, we will have an intermission so that the candidates can mingle with all of you. There will be coffee, lemonade, and also some cookies. Following the intermission, we will then resume the forum. Now, contrary to what we've seen at the national level, we hope this forum provides insight rather than controversy. Thank you very much for attending our forum. With that being said, both Rita and Michael will proceed with the bios and the questions. Thank you very much.
Thank you. First of all, our first candidate, that we will introduce his biography as Aaron Zolman. Aaron, if you could stand up, please. Aaron was born in Warsaw, Indiana in 1983. He has grown up and lived in the Mentone area his entire life. He graduated in the class of 2002 from Tippecanoe Valley with an academic honors diploma. He attended college at Indiana Tech, where he earned his bachelor's of science in industrial and manufacturing engineering. He has a journeyman's card with the United States Department of Labor for design drafter and engineering technician. He is also a certified Six Sigma black belt. Aaron has served in the community and taught junior achievement for 3 years and has been a youth football coach. He worked 10 years at Symmetry Medical in Warsaw. His most current position was a special manufacturing engineer. Currently, he works at Medtronic, where he is part of our advanced sourcing group out of Memphis, Tennessee, residing in Warsaw, holding a position of sourcing engineer, where he focuses on new products, introductions, and commercialization. He is married to Casey Zolman for 7 years with 2 daughters, Gwendolyn and Gia Zolman, ages 3 and 1. He's the son of Jerry and Connie Zolman, Mentone, Indiana.
I want to thank my compadre here for helping out. As you can hear, I'm coming off a sinus infection, so we'll try to get through this. If I croak too much, we'll just turn it over to Micah. Aaron, why are you running for the school board, and what strengths will you utilize to make it most effective?
First off, I want to thank each and every one of you for being here. This is important, and we are a community like no other. Thank you, Mr. Shriver, Mrs. Yazel, and the students for getting the community involved and putting this together. Thank you, Rita, a true legend, and Micah Long with her. First off, you are all presidents of our corporation, and we need to come together to make this school one that everyone wants to be a part of. One that sets the bar for all schools, and one that every teacher dreams of teaching at. I'm running for you, the community, the students, the teachers, and staff. I want to give back to this great school corporation that has been so good to me. I want to preserve what we have while instilling new ideas and concepts to become a top school in Indiana. We have several schools around us that rank very well. We unfortunately are not there yet, but I feel with great direction from the Board of Trustees, commitment from our leaders, and faith in our teachers, we will see great improvements. I'm a leader at heart, and that's what I plan to do as a school board member. I want to make our board work as a team, focus on the important issues for our next generation of leaders. I want to lead our students into the future, knowing that they got the best start available to become successful adults. I want Tippecanoe Valley to be known as that school that everyone wants their kids to go to because of academics, sports, administration, and staff. I want to take that vision and help make it become a reality through thoughtful leadership, dedication, and aspiration. Thank you.
I would like to introduce our next candidate, Tyler Wayne Bowles. Tyler is from Mentone, Indiana. He is running for Tippecanoe Valley School Corporation's Board of Directors for Harrison Township. He was born and raised in Silver Lake, Indiana, where his parents still reside. In 1998, he graduated from Purdue University with a Bachelor of Science degree in Agricultural System Management. He married a fellow Purdue graduate, Melissa Missy, in 2005. They have 3 children, Nash, age 8, Gentry, age 6, and Remington, age 3. All 3 children are proud Bulldogs at Mentone Elementary School. Nash is in 3rd grade, Gentry's in kindergarten, and Remy attends the pre-kindergarten program. Tyler is a district sales manager for AgriGold Hybrids. His wife and he also own and operate Bowles Farms, LLC, where they manage 16,000 wean to finish contract hogs per year. He is on the director of the Farm Bureau Board, and his family attends Warsaw Community Church.
Tyler, what do you think are the current strengths and weaknesses of the corporation? Okay, go on down. What priorities and new ideas would you like to bring to the school system, and why? Did we miss the first question? Okay, Tyler. Why are you running for school board, and what strengths do you utilize to make it most effective?
I can do all three of them.
Why don't you?
Anybody know Dan Tucker? I don't want to see him because he told my wife if I got nervous, just imagine him in his underwear. So I don't want to know where you're at, Dan. Don't even stand up. Okay. Now I know where you're at. I'm ruined. I also want to thank the class for putting this on. I think this is a great opportunity. I know several that are running for school board, some of my friends that are in different districts throughout the state. And they don't, even down closer to Indianapolis and surrounding areas, they do not do something like this. This is fantastic. Why am I running for school board, and what are my strengths? First and foremost, my three children. My family is very involved in the Mentone area. My wife's on the parent group there at Mentone Elementary. My son is on the student council. And I think what better way to continue to build on that vision that they have and their support and the support of every other student out there so that they all have the opportunities then to run for the school board. I have the fundamental belief that every student can graduate. I believe this can be achieved by providing teachers with the administrative support that they need to encourage personal development. It's very imperative though that we connect the students, the parents, the administrative staff and teachers with the upper administration so that everybody feels like they have an open voice, so that that line of communication is transparent. Thank you, Todd, for coming in and giving us the State of the Union of the school. It's difficult to understand government policies, why they do it, when they do it, but we still have to live within those bounds. We have to be able to understand it, we have to be able to interpret it, and we have to be able to implement within those guidelines that they provide us, especially in education. I feel that one of my biggest strengths is throughout my daily life, I'm always dealing with something that the government has imposed on us, from building hog barns because of the permit process that's involved. We've proved that we can coexist, my family has, as well as others, coexist with neighbors, and still live within those guidelines that are imposed upon us. You run into the same thing in on the Kosciuszko County Farm Bureau. You have to understand policy. You either have to understand it and live within it, or not support it. And that is the same within the school education at the state level. So one of my strengths, I feel, as we proceed is that living within government policy is critical. Thank you.
Mr. David O'Brien. Mr. O'Brien's a 1971 graduate of Mississippi High School.
You nervous?
He's a United States Air Force veteran. He's a manufacturing group leader at Zimmer Biomet for 29 years. He's married to his wife Diane McClone O'Brien for 34 years. He has four children: Corey Smith, the 1989 Tivoli High School graduate; Lindsay Elliott, 2001 graduate; Ashley Castro, a 2003 graduate; and Keegan O'Brien, a 2009 graduate of Tippecanoe Valley High School. He's a member of the Burkitt Volunteer Fire Department for the past 33 years. He's also a member of the Warsaw American Legion. Mr. O'Brien has lived in the area for 41 years.
Okay, Dave, I think you get that same question. Why are you running for the school board, and what strengths will you utilize to make it most effective?
My feeling is the school corporation is all about the kids. We've got to train and teach our kids to be good citizens, good adults, good students, and get them ready for the outside world. Strengths, I've been around the school board for I'll let everybody know, 16 and a half years. I feel like we've accomplished quite a bit. I know the ins and outs, kind of what the state's trying to do to us now. It's not pleasant, like Todd said. They keep taking more money. We try to do more with less each year. Why we even do a budget is beyond me, because we set for 2 months doing a budget. This is what we want to do. The state says, no, this is what we're going to give you. So then we got to sit down and figure out how we can run our corporation with the money that they give us to run with. And each year it keeps getting less and less, and they keep asking us to do more and more. It gets frustrating at times, but I don't really think the state cares. My feeling is they're out to get rid of public schools. They want the voucher program, and that's the way they keep going about it, and it just keeps getting worse.
Next, I would like to introduce Mr. Matt Smith. Matt has grown up and lived all but 4 years of his life here in the Akron area. He went to school at Akron and Tippecanoe Valley, as well as his children. His oldest daughter graduated in 2015, while his youngest is a sixth grader at the middle school currently. He has been serving in our community in various capacities, including softball coach at the Akron Youth League. He served on the Akron 4th of July committee. He was a board member for the Beaver Dam Better 4-H'ers, and he's a small group leader for the fourth grade graders in his church. He works for D.R. Smith Trucking as an operations manager and also as a farmer. Prior to that, he worked for a local company that allowed him to consult and collaborate with surgeons and manufacturers here in the States and abroad. He has a lot of life experience and background that can provide positive influence to ensure children are receiving opportunities to help them excel in their future. Mr. Smith.
Thank you.
Matt, why are you running for school board in Palm Springs? You have a place to make it most effective.
Reason I'm running for school board is I am a big part of this community. I believe in this community, and I want to see our children grow up and stay in this community. Our children are our future, as everybody says. I feel that my knowledge and background that I have experienced over the course of my short-term life can be very positive to the school board and to this corporation. I also believe that our community depends on the ability of our teachers and staff to bring excellent qualities to our student. This means supporting our teachers and listening to our teachers and our community when they're saying what we want to do and how we want to see things come about. I realize that government has a lot of influence on the funding that we receive and can distribute back into the classroom. But at the same time, we as a community has a bigger influence on each individual child as they go through school. Thank you.
I would now like to introduce Mr. Adam Heckerman. Adam Heckerman is the president and CEO of Splendor Boats Company in Silver Lake, Indiana. He graduated from Tippecanoe Valley High School in 2001, and in 2005 he earned his Bachelor's of Science degree in Small Business Management from Manchester College. Adam resides near Silver Lake with his wife Crystal and his daughter Abigail. Adam is deeply invested in the community as the president of Echoes of the Past Tractor Club, a member of the Warsaw Breakfast Optimist Club, a member of the Valley Hometown Advisory Board, and a member of Valley's Career and Technical Committee. He is extremely proud to be a distinguished alumnus from Tippecanoe Valley and wants to give back to the school and community that has given him so much.
Hey, Adam, same question.
That works. Is this one working? Okay.
Well, I just want to say it's a pleasure to be here tonight, and I just want to thank the political economics class for putting this on. This is a great opportunity for not only us as candidates to express our views, but for the students and the public to hear what we have to say. So when I consider running, there's many reasons why I decided to run, but there's two that really stand out to me. Number one, my daughter. I truly, deeply care about my daughter's education. Two, I want to make a positive difference. I don't only want to make a positive difference in my daughter's education, I want to make a positive difference in the community. So those really mean a lot to me. You know, I just want to say it's an honor to stand up here in front of all of you and tell you that I was born and raised in this community, and to tell you how proud I am to say that I'm an alumni from this school. And you know, one day when my daughter walks across that stage and grabs that diploma, I want to make sure she feels the same pride that I feel. Okay? And so, as a small business leader and as an owner of a business that hires alumni here in our community, I feel like my leadership, my teamworking skills, and my day-to-day skills with working with finance gives me the talents and the skills necessary to make me an effective board member. I also feel like a board member needs to be deeply rooted in the community. It's important that if you're deeply rooted, you're gonna have the passion, motivation to do what's right for the community and the school. I'm a business owner, I'm an alumnus, I'm a parent, and I'm a spouse of an educator. I am deeply committed, and I promise you, I will always put our children first. Thank you.
Stephanie has been an employee at Kosciuszko County Community Foundation for the past 16 years. She is the associate director in that capacity, and she leads the foundation's marketing efforts, the board's strategic grant-making initiatives, and human resources. She is involved in public relations, governance, scholarship, grant, agriculture, and finance and investment committees for the foundation. Prior to joining the foundation, she operated her own marketing firm serving small business and nonprofit in Kosciuszko County. She has also taught classes at Ivy Tech Community College. Stephanie earned her undergraduate degree in marketing and communications from Ball State University and a master's degree in business administration from Indiana Wesleyan University. She is also a graduate of the Kosciuszko Leadership Academy, a Richard Luger Excellence in Public Service graduate, former court-appointed special advocate for abused and neglected children, a member of the Rotary, and has served on various other volunteer boards and committees. She resides in Seward Township with her husband, Jamie, a Tippecanoe Valley graduate, and their triplets, Maris, Ellis, and Gage, who are in third grade at Akron Elementary.
Stephanie, same question to you. Why do you want to do this?
Thanks, Rita. You know, at first I wasn't sure I did. That's the honest answer. It's something I've thought about for several years. Several family members and friends and neighbors encouraged me to run, and it was something I thought about. I thought, wow, that would take a lot of time. I don't know if that's something I'd want to do, and so it's something I've thought about and prayed about for several years. And I've been going to school board meetings regularly for more than a year so that I could understand the role that our current board has. And so it's something I've thought a lot about. But the main reason that I'm running for school board is because I have three children in the school corporation. And I want them and your children to have the best possible education. And I want them, when they graduate, to have every opportunity available to them to go into a vocation, trade, a career, or on to college. Secondly, I really care about children. I think that's evident by my past work with abused and neglected children through CASA. I'm on the board for Gradway, which is doing work right here in Tippy Valley, along with three other corporations, helping students at risk for dropping out of high school not drop out. We want to make sure they cross that stage. My strengths are, I want to just highlight three strengths. Number one, I'm well-informed and experienced. I call myself sort of a data geek. I really love research and data, and I think it's important that when we make decisions about policy and curriculum that we understand the facts. But I'm also a mom. And so I call it mom sense, you might call it common sense. Data doesn't tell us everything, and I think sometimes we just have to put things past that litmus test of what does a mom think, what does a dad think, what does a teacher think. I base my decisions on research and common sense. I'm well-informed and experienced. And most importantly, I feel like I'm a good listener. I know enough to know that I don't know everything. And so it's really important for me to be able to talk to the people that are in the trenches every day, teachers, principals, parents, students, and ask them, what's happening in your classroom? What's preventing you from making the progress with your students that you'd want to make? And what are you most proud of? So I'm a good listener. I'm well-informed. My decisions are based on research and common sense. And I have three kids that make me want to have Tippy Valley School Corporation the best corporation out there. Thank you.
Jim, we need a little bit of a hint here. Are we switching the order of people coming up? Okay, timer. What do you think are the current strengths and weaknesses of the corporation?
I believe the current strengths of this corporation are fairly obvious in terms of the people, the administrative, the administrators, the educators, and the staff. Without that, we would not have the pride that we have to be Tippecanoe Valley Vikings. That is utmost the biggest strength of this school corporation. The other strengths as it relates to the school board and the administration, the current administration is very fiscally responsible by the leadership of the school board and Mr. Boggs. They work well within their means, which is very important, as we all know. They have tight margins, and those tight margins, as everybody knows, whether it's in the household, whether it's with children, or whether it's in a business or a school system, we've got to work within it, and I think we need to continue to do that because that is a strength, even though that we are limited on funds. Weaknesses, probably the elephant in the room, and it was already discussed a little bit, is the decline in enrollment since 2007. As you have a decline in enrollment with the current administration, the policies, that's where the funding comes from, so there's a decrease in funding. We will discuss that more in question number five. We'll go more in depth into that. But two others are the education scores of the middle and high school. I think we need to work on those to get those increased. They have done that. They have gone up a grade level. We need to continue to do that so that we continue to attract students. And then open communication between principals so that the morale of everybody in the system continues to be positive, upbeat, so that we can live within our means and do the best we can for the students.
The same question, what do you think are the current strengths and weaknesses of the corporation?
Our current strengths now are we are starting to offer more AB college courses for our students to get credits for college before they ever graduate high school. And that is one of the strengths that we have out there. Weaknesses? Technology. Technology is something that changes constantly. You can't keep up with it. It changes daily. You think we have a hold of it, and next thing you know, it's something else comes along. But we're working more and more on that, and that seems to be one of the weaknesses out there. Our school corporation administrators, I think right now we have in place good administrators. Our school buildings are now in good shape. When we get the Akron project done, we have buildings now that are the best around. And we haven't raised our taxes for the taxpayers. That's a plus for them. We were able to do this by keeping an eye on our budget. The I don't know. Like I said, the technology is the hardest one, I think. That's probably our biggest weakness, and it'll always be a weakness. I don't know if you'll ever get a grip on it. It's hard to stay in front of. You can't get in front of it, so I think that's all the weaknesses we really have right now.
Thank you. weaknesses, strengths?
I feel our strengths. I feel that we have a good teaching staff throughout the Tippecanoe Valley School Corporation, Akron, Mentone, the middle school and high school. I think that we don't thank our teachers enough. I think that's a weakness of ours for what they do. They go through and they work hard to prepare their lessons, to teach our kids, and we fail to remember that job is sometimes a thankless job. I also think that we fall short on communication. Communication on what, where, and when things are going on, and not only what and where things are going on, but what kind of tools are available to our students. Whether it be at the elementary level, middle school level, or high school level. I feel that we strive to make these weaknesses go away, but we're still falling short in certain areas. Thank you for your time.
Adam, same question. Weaknesses, strengths.
Sorry, I'm pretty tall, so I figured I better pick up the mic. Hands down, our staff. If any of you have walked through our buildings during the day like I have, you're going to see that our educators and our staff truly care about the well-being of our kids. It's obvious. And I promise to be an advocate for our educators. They're our number one resource, folks. With the teacher shortage in Indiana today, it's important that we take care of our educators and treat them with respect. Second, our community. We have one of the best communities in the state of Indiana, I feel. Our community not only supports our school financially, but it supports academically, athletically. We have a great community, and you know what? I'm proud to be a part of it. Third, our facility. We have a great, beautiful facility. But you kind of wonder, do we use it to its fullest? And we get into some of our weaknesses. I think one of the other candidates mentioned poor communication. I see that from the outside. Communication is very poor, not only between the board and the community, but the board and the educators, and the educators and the administration. Communication is awful. If we're going to make our education better, folks, we need to start working as a team. It's important. Financially. You know, we are financially strong. We are a financially strong school. But you have to wonder, are we spending the dollars where they need to go? Are we spending the money in the classroom and supplying our educators with the tools that are necessary? We all have to kind of wonder. So if I were elected a new school board member, I would make sure that we check into these weaknesses and make sure our teachers are funded and have the supplies that are necessary. Thank you.
Weaknesses and strengths.
Well, I'm not as tall as Adam, but I wore high heels, and they're just for you because they're really uncomfortable. I'll start with strengths. I love the people of Tippecanoe Valley. I moved a lot when I was a kid, and so this is the longest I've ever lived anywhere. And it's home to me. My children have had every teacher at Akron Elementary School from kindergarten to third grade. And they've been excellent. I just want to tell you just a little bit about how excellent they've been. I've had teachers that have met with us after school, not for parent-teacher conferences, but for an extra session when we had a concern about one of our children. One of my son's teachers, now my son is a good student, but he doesn't particularly care for school because it isn't outside. And so that teacher made learning really fun for him during a critical year. I've had teachers who've come to soccer games, not because they have children that are playing soccer, but because they have students who are playing soccer. And so, hands down, the community of Tippecanoe Valley is our greatest asset. We have a healthy financial reserve, which you've talked about, and we're lucky we do because small corporations are closing. But I should mention that we used to be 2,000 and above. We didn't used to be the next tier on the chopping block. Just 5 years ago, we were the third tier. And so that declining enrollment is really hurting us. I'm proud of some of the investments the board's made, like in preschool and transportation, to help children access vocational and trades opportunities that are no longer available in rural communities. We have our challenges. I've studied data for the last 10 years. ISTEP and SAT scores are below state average every year for 10 years. I don't like the ISTEP, but parents make decisions about where to buy a house and where to put their kids based on things like grades of school corporations, and those are heavily based on ISTEP, so we have to close that achievement gap. SAT scores lower for the last 10 years than across the state. That's important for college-bound students to get into the college that they want to get into. In 2014-15, nearly 4 out of every 10 high school students at Tybee Valley failed their end-of-year course assessments in math and English. That concerns me. So I'm seeing my stop sign, so I'm going to stop, but thank you.
Here are the strengths and weaknesses.
Thank you. So every school has their strengths, and I think, you know, every school has their weakness. We're no different than any other school. Our teachers need to come first. They're our front line, and they're out there every day fighting the battle in the efforts of leading our children into the future. We need to have more legacy opportunities. And by what I mean is, I would love to see more kids graduating from college and wanting to come back to Tippecanoe Valley and teach. We have several here, and one in particular that I can think of. Her dad was a teacher, and she followed his legacy and came back to be a very successful teacher and a great overall leader. We need to have more encouragement of our children that are interested in teaching at Tippecanoe Valley. Yes, you know, there might be shortages of teachers, but we can self-fulfill our needs by creating environments that create this awareness. We want to continue those legacies and pitching a place for the future of our children. Our community is one tight-knit community and one that I'm so very proud to be part of. We have come together through the good times and through the bad. We're one like no other I have seen, and it's passed through our school corporation. At times, when you have such a good community in school, it is tough to change things and accept change. But what I fear, if we don't, we're not looking out for the future of our generations to come. I fear we will get left behind in paradigms of the past and not giving students the chance they need to become successful. Thank you.
Okay, this is the last question before the break. Dave,
what priorities and
what new ideas would you like to bring to the school system in Hawkeye?
First off, I really don't think I have a priority. I know we try to promote our children to go to college. They need to go to college. College is very important. But also, my aspect is auto mechanics is just important. And I would love to see auto mechanics come back to Tippecanoe Valley. I know we have a ag teacher now that is going to try to definitely build our ag mechanics program, and I hope he succeeds immensely. Other things is like CNC equipment, computer numerical control. I mean, I would love to see that at Tippecanoe Valley. The Warsaw in this area, machinists are in high demand, and our kids have to go to Warsaw Career Center or Ivy Tech or something like that to learn that. I wish that Tippecanoe Valley could get a CNC machine so our students could learn programming, get more hands-on. College is important, but so is hands-on. Not everybody goes to college. And I think we shortchange some of our kids that don't. They need this extra. And I do feel that our new ag teacher is going to help a lot there. But, thank you.
Same question. What are the priorities of the system and why?
Priorities.
I'd like to see some of the latest technologies be available to our students in one form or another. It don't have to be that exact thing, but to be able to see it, to utilize it in some fashion. I'd like to also see a class developed potentially at the middle school level and hopefully proceeding up into the high school level that kids can get a hands-on of how this technology comes about. You know, all these kids have their phones and their electronic devices, as all they do is know how to operate them. They don't know how they all came together. Somebody had to invent them. And it could be one of our kids that invents the latest and greatest thing coming forward. I'd also like to see a general business class developed in our upper high school levels, in our junior and senior year class. It doesn't matter if you own your own business or if you work for somebody else, you still need those general business skills of how to manage your money throughout your life. Thank you.
Well, when I looked at priorities, I think we need to look back at the last question, some of the weaknesses. I think priority number one is to open up channels of communication. If we're going to be an effective teaching institution, we need to open up the communication, because if we don't have communication, what do we have? So I think it's very important that we work as a team, because last time I checked, we're all here for the same reason, and that's to give our kids the best education possible. And if we're not effectively communicating, that's not possible. So we need to work together. Second, I think we need to push and offer more AP and dual credit courses. With the cost of college these days, the rising cost, dual credit is very important. A lot of you, if you don't know what that is kids can get these dual credits and college credits in their senior, junior, senior year of high school. And when they start their freshman year of college, they're already ahead. So it's a cost savings, as well as a boost in their jump start in college. And then AP courses. We need these AP courses to make sure that our kids know how to write papers when they get to college, and that they know how to write resumes when they go into the workforce. It's very important. And one that's really deep to my heart is vocational education. A couple of the other candidates have mentioned this, but this is deep to my heart as being a business owner here in our community. I see the lacking skills that our graduates have when they come into the workforce. And we need to make sure that we can bring some of these vocational education courses, not to the Career Center in Warsaw, but right here in our school. We have the facility to do it, but not only do we need to start a program, we need to work with local business owners and teach our kids skills that give them the skills for local business, whether it be tool and die auto mechanics, marine mechanics. But we want our kids, this is economic development 101. When our kids graduate, we don't want them to move away. We want them to stay right here and have a successful career and raise their families. This is what we want. So it's very important. And I think that's why I'm passionate and why I serve on Valley's Career and Technical Board. I think it's important. And I'm very passionate about it. And I want to make sure our kids are prepared for the future.
Same question. Well, I struggled with this one a little bit because I wasn't sure if I wanted to give you my honest answer, because it's kind of a hard one, but it is my honest answer. And I think the first priority for Tippy Valley Schools needs to be a cultural change. And cultural changes are the most difficult to make because they're really ingrained in the way that we think about ourselves and talk about ourselves. And in the 12 years that I've been in this district, I've heard us talk about ourselves like we're victims of the circumstances that we're in. And Tippy Valley's better than that. The fact that we're rural and that we're small and that we have a lot of low-income families in our communities and in our schools is not an excuse for poor performance. And I don't accept it as an excuse for poor performance. I know that there are things that need to change at this state, and I have personally written letters to our legislators and lobbied as an independent person for those changes. But we have to get beyond victim, which freezes us in it. There's nothing we can do about it. We can never be better. And we have to get to the victor part, where we say, what can we do? What will it take? And what partnerships, grant opportunities, and God forbid, a little bit of that surplus funding do we need to use in order to make our students have the resources that they need and our teachers be a little less overwhelmed? I've been to school board meetings where we've spent 30 minutes listening to a wonderful special education teacher talk about all the time she put into writing a $1,500 grant. That makes me angry. I hope it makes you angry, because I don't want her gifts in writing $1,500 grants. I appreciate her work. Please don't misunderstand. But it is a misuse of her valuable skills and her time. We, as a corporation, as a board, need to allocate those resources. So the number one priority that I would make was that cultural change, where we expect teachers to come up with the enrichment things that they need in their classrooms. And as a community, we need to provide those things for those teachers. Thanks.
So most of us live less than 30 minutes from the orthopedic capital of the world. I know many of you out there work at one of these places. Actually, let's show of hands. How many people out there works at one of those orthopedic places in Warsaw? We got a few here, okay. So there are thousands of jobs in Warsaw, all types of jobs being created, but the main job force is machine operators and machinists. I think Dave kind of alluded to this. With one of the big three is losing more than 50% of its machinists in the next 5 years due to retirement. I want to see, let's get those kids that are wanting to get into that industry and get them a head start. I want to provide classes such as a machine tools class, CNC programming. Let them get out there and get their hands dirty and work on that. I want to be able to partner with some of those corporations and companies and help provide success to our students. I think a machine tool class would be a great benefit to our school. Secondly, I'd like to see more student athlete recognition. Let's face it, going to school all day, then practicing games till late, and still being able to shuffle homework and studies isn't easy. I want to bring more recognition and attention to those students who are able to handle that load and become successful. By coming up with ideas and concepts that support these kinds of efforts, I want to see this as an opportunity to get more students involved as well. I feel a lot of successful individuals did not go home from school each day and play video games. They were part of a team. They learned what hard work was. I want to see more students getting involved and finding ways to get student involvement. If they were willing to play, let's find a way for them to be a part of the team. And lastly, I feel we need to move the bar. We have some of the most advanced classes students could ask for. Let's provide those classes to the students here at Tippecanoe Valley. I think it's great they can go to the nearby schools and get some of those, but I want to see those classes here at Tippecanoe Valley. I know we have kids at all different levels, but they must be able to deliver to a wide range of students. My strategy is this: let's move that range. Let's set the bar higher for our students and bring those along with those higher standards. Our minds are a powerful thing, and I think no matter what you pitch or what level you are at, we can make them all successful achievers no matter what. Thank you.
Same question.
Okay, priorities and new ideas to bring to the school system. I feel that the biggest challenge is to stop the decrease in enrollment and then provide a drawing cards where we are a draw to students and surrounding, because there's no borders anymore, that we are a draw somewhere that people, that students and parents want to send their students to. So we need a targeted effort to increase enrollment at Tippecanoe Valley School Corporation. As everyone's mentioned, we need to excel in the vocational education, college readiness, and as well as increase education scores to attract those students. Listen, I work with a lot of students coming out of college when they're hired on with us to train them. It's sometimes difficult because the lack of confidence and ambition is a big thing that seems to be taking place in a lot of students. That's at the college level. If you take that down to the high school level, if we can train them in vocational education, in any type of, whether it's machining, whether it's through FFA or an ag program, any additional training in college readiness we can give these kids to send them out in the world will increase their ambition and increase their confidence and make them more successful. I think that is huge. One thing that I personally, as a parent and or a school board member, would be to connect the board more efficiently and effectively with the principals. I would, as a parent and also a school board member, meet with each principal of each school and ask them what their needs, personally ask them, walk through the school, sit through the school with them, ask them what their needs, what their strengths and weaknesses are, and what their needs are, and get a priority list, because it's all gonna take funding, so you have to create a priority list and then attach that to a budget and make it happen. But we need open communication with those principals so that they can still provide positive morale to their educators in that school system.
I think we're going to the 15-minute intermission, so you can mingle. So we'll be back in 15 minutes.
Digital citizenship while using their electronic devices. Things that we scold our students, our kids, for not using appropriate language or taking inappropriate, what we may think is inappropriate pictures or something like that. But nobody's teaching them how, what good citizenship of using those electronic devices and posting good quality comments back and using good grammar while posting those comments back. Need to also increase the number of computers and tablets that have access to the web for research purposes. Also need to add communication going out to parents. Better communication to utilize them, what's going on in the school, what technologies are available to those students. Thank you.
Mr. Heckerman, how do you believe that Tippecanoe Valley can utilize technology to prepare students for the 21st century?
Thanks, Micah. Well, we all know technology is constantly changing by the minute. So I think the question we need to ask is, are we committed to the change? Is our school committed to keep up with the change in technology? That is the first question we need to ask ourselves. Let me give you a little example. If you're gonna go out to the store and buy a brand new smart TV, latest, greatest technology, are you gonna bring it home and hook it up to a VCR? I don't think so. And sometimes I feel like that's what we try to do. We try to pinch pennies, use older technology, and try to make things work, and it's just not effective. You know, I'm not saying we have to have the latest and greatest, but I feel like we need to just make sure that we're constantly paying attention to what we have and maintaining our technology. In the past few years, I've had some graduates that have worked for me part-time,
And I've kind of quizzed them a little bit about what they had and what they dealt with in the school. And it was kind of interesting, the responses I got. I actually had one of them tell me that, you know, in their technology and drafting classes that they were using computers that were over 10 years old. I think we all know that computers go out of date within 4 years easily. And so I guess we need to ask ourselves, are we truly keeping technology up in our school system? You know, if we want to bring in new teaching methods, such as Project Lead the Way, which we have brought in this year, which I think is a great opportunity for our kids to have hands-on learning. But these teaching methods take newer technology, and we need to make sure that our educators are staffed with the right technology to be able to teach these classes. Whether you like it or not, we are a technology-driven society, and that is our future, and so we need to make sure that we are committed to the change. We need to make sure our kids are prepared for the future by finding a way that is both effective for our educators to teach and our students to learn. Thank you.
Mrs. Overby, how do you believe that Tippecanoe Valley can utilize technology to prepare students for the 21st century?
Well, I'll start by sharing a story. About 3 years ago for Mother's Day, my husband bought me a Kindle. So my kids were about five, and I enjoyed finding books on it and looking up on the internet. And I don't know, maybe 3 or 4 weeks after I'd had the Kindle, one of my five-year-olds came up to me and said, "Look at the pictures I took, Mommy." And I said, "That thing takes pictures?" So I say that story to say that it's not enough for our students to have access to technology. They have to know how to use the technology in a relevant way, and teachers have to be trained. If a teacher, a very good teacher, graduated from college 10 years ago, imagine the technology that has happened and is available between when they graduated and were trained as a teacher and in their classroom today. It's a lot. I know at my work just today, we researched the cost of training our staff on the next upgrade to Outlook. So I know technology is different in the school than it is in my office, but we have to invest in helping teachers know how to use technology. It's not enough to have the computer, to have the device. But as one of the other candidates mentioned, Project Lead the Way is a great resource that's already available. We need to utilize it more so that it doesn't just provide curriculum, it provides training for teachers on how to implement things like robotics, CNC, engineering into the curriculum at every grade level from K through 12, which is exciting. So my investments wouldn't just be in support of the actual technology, but also in training teachers on how to use that technology. They're capable, they just need the training and the support. Thanks.
Mr. Zolman, how do you believe that Tippecanoe Valley can utilize technology to prepare students for the 21st century?
Thank you, Micah. To cope with the demands of the 21st century, students need to know more in the core subjects. They need to know how to use their knowledge and skills by thinking critically, applying knowledge to new situations, analyzing information, comprehending new ideas, communicating, collaborating, solving problems, and making decisions. This idea will not only prepare students for the future, but it will help bring up test scores as well. A philosophy of mine is teaching children they are all engineers. Teach them to learn their own abilities, how to pursue what they're good at, and what they have the desire to do. Don't push kids to become a doctor when they really want to become a lawyer. We are setting them up for failure. I want to see more programs for kids to discover what they're passionate about. More opportunities for them to take a look at different areas to become successful adults. They need these opportunities at all age levels and develop these acumens to discover who they are. I too am going to talk about Project Lead the Way. What a great thing that the school is starting to implement. We're just getting on board. But this needs to be implemented right away at all age levels, at all of our schools. Teaching kids of all ages to think on their own and bringing out the creativity of each student. We are all creative, but we just don't know it yet. We need to find ways to bring children out of their shells and help develop lifelong skills. Thank you.
Mr. Ballas, how do you believe that Tippecanoe Valley can utilize technology to prepare students for the 21st century?
This is probably one of the most exciting questions to me. I went to high school, graduated in 1994, aged myself a little bit, but I learned keyboarding on a typewriter. Anybody use typewriter lately? No. Not very many people do, at least. Now I don't go anywhere without this. That's how fast times have changed, or I've gotten older, probably both. But as we get older, and as we adapt, I think we need to better utilize technology to make it a big part of the school system so that we can adapt better to these millennials. This is exciting. This is exciting to a student, it's exciting to a 3-year-old, it's exciting to a 16-year-old. And to make learning exciting, I think we need to better utilize technology. The one-to-one is a term that the charter schools began it when they really started using computers and tablets. One-to-one is using a computer, a tablet, or a laptop to do lessons on, to do homework on. It is something that we have began to adapt in the middle schools, in the high schools, through the use of laptops and logging on. But it needs to be more concentrated. One-to-one is a more concentrated way of learning to keep individual tabs. It logs the progression of each student's success in that class and on that individual on that individual math or science, so that they can the teacher can better correlate with where that student is at in terms of their what their needs and wants may be. ISTEP is done live online. I just learned that a week ago. So if the government is, if they're doing ISTEP live online, then we need to adapt this in a quicker fashion, because I think it'll make learning more exciting.
Mr. O'Brien, how do you believe that Tippecanoe Valley can utilize technology to prepare students for the 21st century?
Okay, about 4 years ago, we enacted computers at the high school. And the high school's been, I think this is their fourth year with the computers, and this year we initiated the one-on-one at the middle school. So now all middle school children have a laptop to work with. Eventually, that needs to trickle down to the elementary schools to teach them how to use it, because this is the future. Like Mr. Bauss said, everybody knows how to use it. I have a granddaughter that shows me how to use my cell phone because I don't know how to use it. And if we don't get a hold of that and teach these kids and get them in, the sad part is it takes funds. And the funds are the ones that's hard to find, because the state's not going to give it to you. So we have to figure out a way to come up with the funds to buy these. Now, I know we have a surplus of money, but that can be depleted in a matter of a few months. And next thing you know, we're like everybody else borrowing money, and we don't want to do that. But we definitely got to get laptops into the elementary schools eventually. Thank you.
Mr. Heckerman, we will begin our next set of questions. How do you plan to address our declining student enrollment?
Well, this is an interesting question, isn't it? As Todd stated, you know, that is how the schools are funded now. And so whether we like it or not, it comes down to competition. So we need to make sure our school is competitive with other surrounding schools. Are we offering the right technology? Do we have enough AP and upper level dual credit courses? Are we offering enough extracurricular activities? And are we offering vocational education that is in demand in our community? I believe if we offer programs that are in demand in our community, we will reach out to more students. Number two, I think we need to change this perception of negativity towards our school. I've heard it, I'm sure you've heard it, but whether we like it or not, or whether we believe it, there is a perception of negativity towards our school. I believe we can start by making positive changes,
and we need to boost morale within our schools. Not just our educators and our staff, but our kids. They're our number one promoter. I'm telling you right now, if good things are happening, if our morale is boosted, our teachers and our students are the ones that are going to go out into the community and tell people what's going on. So I believe we need to do that. I believe if we focus on these two things, first off, I believe our school will market itself. We must all perform to our best because you know what? It starts with us. It starts with us, the board, with the educators, and the administration. Thank you.
Mrs. Overby, how do you plan to address our declining student enrollment?
Well, any successful business owner will tell you that it's much easier to retain a happy customer than to have to go out and market and get a new customer. And so the very first thing that we need to do is we need to stop the bleed. And we can do that by surveying, talking to, having groups like this come together and say, what do you love about your child's educational experience? And what are you concerned about? In the last 5 years, we've lost 162 students in enrollment, and that is a net loss. So I respectfully disagree that it's just people who are moving into the city. It includes people who, the net loss means that we've gained some and we've lost some, but the net loss is 162 students. That's more than an entire graduating class of Vikings that we've lost. 33% of the people that responded to my poll, and there were only 40, so this is not a statistical poll for a full disclosure, but 33% of them said that and they were people who had children in the system, said they have considered pulling their children out of Tippi Valley and enrolling them in a different school. And nearly the number one answer is because of perceived opportunity somewhere else. And so if we're gonna stop the bleed, if we're gonna attract new families, we have to invest in opportunities in STEM, vocational and trade, and not just curriculum, but also extracurriculars. Two very good friends of mine have chosen to leave the district and go somewhere else. One of them had a high school student who wasn't particularly interested in either athletics or ag and felt like there was nowhere for him to belong. That's sad. If a small school should do anything well, it should be a place where everyone has a place to belong. And we need to offer that for our students. And then, you know what, the big school, you know what they can't be? They can't be small. We're small. We're small enough to change. It takes less effort to turn a small boat around than a big one, right? So we've talked about our challenges, but we have what it takes to change. And so what I would do is change the things that our current families and the ones that we track down and say, why did you leave? What they said went wrong. Thanks.
Mr. Zoltman, how do you plan to address our declining student enrollment?
I believe the enrollment can rise and fall based on the school's leadership. I'm not picking on any one person, but collectively as a whole, including the board, we need to provide visionary and inspirational leadership. Ineffective leadership will almost always result in enrollment decline. If the parents, faculty, and staff do not believe in the leadership of the school, it will be difficult to grow the enrollment without vision and direction. In addition, the school's leadership must intentionally focus on leading the enrollment effort. It starts from the top and should permeate every area of the school. I want to challenge our leadership to come up with more creative ways it feels are appropriate. I mean that in the best way possible. I am challenged every day, and I feel it is the only way we will make ourselves better. It's not the teacher's responsibility to do recruiting. I truly believe if you build it, they will come. We will build a school system that is known for having the best teachers, the best academics, the most prepared students for college and adulthood. By having some of the most advanced classes and narrow specific scope, we will adheredly bring more students to Tippecanoe Valley. I want to set goals and measure to them. Being a lean guy, I truly believe in the DMAIC approach. Define, measure, analyze, improve, and control. Let's set up some teams, maybe even a marketing class, whose students can give their input, all while setting up those who want to go to college for a business degree get a head start. Let's try to think outside the box and really try to connect with those who are on the front line. Thank you.
Mr. Bowles, how do you plan to address our declining student enrollment?
The declining student enrollment is causing the decrease in funds, so we've got to stop the bleeding, as Stephanie said. I feel it's critical that we continue the public outreach in an attempt to increase our district's enrollment. The district has hired a publicist to do this, which I support, because since we have open borders, it's like any other business. You've got to go out, you have got to publicize what we've got, those drawing cards that we've got, but we've got to create more by increasing our vocational education courses, the opportunities that exist within them that support local businesses, which will support us also. They've proven that. We've got to continue to increase our college readiness to promote that, because we do have a strong college readiness program in place. College prep, and just increase our overall scores so that parents are attracted to send their student here. By far, that's probably the number one thing that a publicist can use to attract parents, because they want to feel safe where they send their parents. The infrastructure, the educational platforms, athletics, agriculture, those are all in place. Those are all great. We were lucky enough to get a principal, Mr. Doms, at Mentone. He came from Leesburg. Warsaw is known for beautiful big buildings, and I asked him, I said, what was your attraction to here? Not that it was negative, I just wanted to know, because my children go there, all three of them. And he said, you know what, a beautiful building doesn't make the people inside happy. So as long as we keep our educators happy and we increase our scores, make it exciting, we will attract students. I think that's a key thing that we need to promote.
Mr. O'Brien, how do you plan to address our declining student enrollment?
That's a good question, because us and every corporation around is facing the same thing. And we have to promote Tippecanoe Valley as to be the best around, and that's how I believe, firmly believe, if we start a vocational program and get more kids interested in that, a CNC program, our ag program getting better, eventually getting our ag program into the middle school could attract more kids. We are offering now more pre-kindergarten, and a lot of people like to bring their kids. They can drop them off going to work, and that would get more people coming to our school district than Warsaw. A big school is not always the best school, but we also got to get robotics in our school. We've got to get the STEM education. These are things that we've got to promote too. We just hired a PR director and a grant writer. So like they said before, we have teachers writing grants. Hopefully our new grant writer is going to do this for us, that frees up our teachers so they can educate, and the grant writer can do grant writing for us and promote our school. He has been doing a super job trying to get it out to the public, and I just feel like promoting our school, and the people in our community have to promote our school. I mean, the negativity, somebody says, well, Valley stinks or something like that. That doesn't promote anything. We've got to talk positive about our school, and until we start doing that, it's the bleeding that's got to stop.
Mr. Smith, how do you plan to address our declining student enrollment?
Well, like Todd alluded to at the very beginning, we are one of many rural schools that are facing this economic downturn and problem with our student decline. We need to ask ourselves, why are these students leaving the school? Is it because of jobs? Is it because of other reasons that we're maybe not aware of, or we're not seeing the writing on the wall? We also need to ask ourselves,
what can we do to acquire these students? You know, what technologies, what classes, whether it be technical or advanced AP classes, what are we not offering that makes another school more inviting to that student to come on board? We also, I believe that our teachers and everybody works very hard at making the school a great school. But I think that if we effectively build this program to open up and enlighten the kids in our area that go to school, other kids outside of this area will see and want to come here as well. Thank you.
Mrs. Overby, you will lead us in our final question. Will you please make some closing remarks and address issues that you feel have been addressed thus far in our forum?
Sure, thank you. First of all, I've spent my career in marketing. It's what I went to for undergrad in marketing. And a lot of people just think of one of the P's. There are four P's of marketing. And people think of the P that's called promotion, that's advertising. But there's product, place, price, and then promotion is last. And we can promote all we want about how great Tippy Valley is, and we have a lot of great in Tippy Valley. But if the product that we are offering is not what consumers are demanding, then it doesn't matter how much we market it. If they get here and find out they've bought a lie, they won't stay. And so we have to invest in product, which is the quality of education. And we can. We are already. We've made good strides. So that's my final point, is that we can't just focus on the P, the promotion, in marketing. But lastly, I just want to spend a few seconds thanking my family. I could not even consider running for school board if I didn't have a fantastic husband. So Jamie, thank you. When I am serving the community, when I've been going to school board meetings and sitting on committees, I can only do those things in the evenings because he's home with our children. He works all day and does that at night. And thank you, because I couldn't do it without him. I'm blessed. I also want to acknowledge the other candidates. I've gotten to know most of them throughout the campaign. I've met them at least once or twice. And I have to say that every encounter has been respectful and friendly. I wish that our national and state politicians could take some notes from that. And I think we're all running for the same reason. There's a reason that so many young people, and thank you for calling me that, those of you who have, because one of my daughter's kids at preschool told me that I was the oldest mom. I am. But just thank you. Thank you for hosting this. Rita and Micah, thank you for moderating. And students, thank you so much for giving us the opportunity to share our ideas. And thanks for coming out. And that's really all. Thank you.
Mr. Zolman, will you please make some closing remarks and address issues that you feel haven't been addressed thus far in the forum?
Yep. Thank you, Micah. Thank you, everyone, for coming tonight. Appreciate everyone being here. I want to thank my family, friends. This means a lot. You know, this is a lot to put forward and a lot to do, so thank you all for being here. As a school board member, I'm pledging to you, I will always be willing to listen to ideas and concerns. I will provide an inquisitive disposition, and I'll choose to make decisions that are best for our community, teachers, and staff. I believe in having an open mind that will make sound decisions based on research, data, and facts. I will fully participate and have a strong connection with this community and help build a board that works as a team to accomplish goals set forth. I believe in strategies and philosophies that less is more. I will challenge our system to become better. And I will ask the why questions. What are we doing to better ourselves? Education is not one size that fits all. I want to look through past paradigms and look at new opportunities to improve the vision of the school corporation. I'm taking on the task of making our school corporation a top school in the state of Indiana. I look forward to serving for you, and please get out and vote November 8th. Thank you.
Mr. Bowles, will you please make some closing remarks and address the issues that you feel haven't been addressed thus far in the forum?
Well, Dan Tucker's gone, so we don't have to worry about him getting his underwear. First and foremost, thank you everybody for coming out. This was great. The school board's a team effort, as is the administration and the educators involved. I've gotten to know everybody up here, great group of people. Look forward to November 8th, how it turns out. I think it'll be a benefit to the board anyway that it turns out. Because of your children and my children that are in the school system, I believe it's important to increase the excitement and the morale through, and that comes through involvement, that comes through setting examples. My wife is a member of the parent group at Mentone Elementary. Last week, her and a group cut and counted 14,000 box tops. This group puts on a carnival to raise money. They handle the box tops that they send in. 14,000 of them gets $1,400, I believe. And then that gives the educators at Mentone an opportunity. If they have a need, they request it, and that gives additional funding. That is the involvement and the excitement that that I believe is going to propel the school district into the future. My son's on student council. He ran on the platform to have an ag day so that he could help educate the kids at school better on animal agriculture, what all is involved, because there's a lot of misnomers that take place out there. I want to support their activities, and I hope that that I can. It's critically important that the person selected has the understanding of what is happening in the school system. I've got three children in the school system. We need to continue to be involved as a family and continue that appreciation. And I hope that I have or obtain the opportunity to be a part of the school system through the school board. Thank you.
O'Brien, will you please make some closing remarks and address the issues that you feel have not been addressed thus far in the forum?
First off, I'd like to thank the Social and Economic Studies class for putting this on, Micah and Rita for hosting this. And I just think it's great that I've been on school board 16 years, and this is the most candidates I've ever seen run for school board. That tells me that people are starting to get excited about our community. They want to get involved. They want to drive this to make Tippecanoe Valley one of the best school corporations around. Any one of these gentlemen can do that, and I think they're all, and ladies, sorry. I think they're all there for the kids. I hope that's there. I hope they don't have an axe to grind. I hope they want to promote our school and be there for the kids. Like I said, it just excites me to see this many. If I get reelected, that's perfectly fine with me, and I will do my very best to provide Tippecanoe Valley with the best I have for the past 16 years. I mean, I've put my wife through quite a bit in 16 years. I mean, I've missed a lot of my granddaughter's games, because I got a board meeting and I can't miss that board meeting. I got to go to it. She goes, you can miss one. And I said, no, I can't. I was elected to do that, and I'm doing it. So I'm just excited about the candidates. And I hope this is not a stop. I hope it continues. People getting involved, our community getting involved, and just good luck to everybody.
Mr. Smith, will you please make some closing remarks and address the issues that you feel have not been addressed thus far in the forum?
First of all, I want to thank the community for coming out. I want to thank the class for putting this event on, and thank the commentators. Really appreciate everything that everybody has done. I want to thank my wife and my children for standing up and standing behind me. They go through a lot while I've been preparing for this, so. things that we want to address. I think that our school system really needs to consider bringing back some of the technical trait. We've all discussed it all the way through this. I think it's something that needs to happen because it's being lost in our society and in our community. I just want to take everybody to think about what that kid, you know, not everybody is prone to go directly to college, and they need something to work on at the very beginning. And a technical trade is not a bad thing to have. Thank you.
Mr. Heckerman, will you please make some closing remarks that address the issues that you feel have not been addressed thus far in the forum?
Thanks, Micah. Well, I just want to say thank you very much, like everyone else has, for the invitation tonight. It was a true honor to be able to stand up here before you and share my thoughts. I want to thank my family and my wife for supporting me in this endeavor. And I just want to kind of close up tonight with how I feel. I believe if we truly work together as a team, we can and we will make a difference. And we will find creative solutions for our school's challenges. We will open up communication, we will boost morale, we will change our school's reputation, and we will provide the best education possible. And that's because we can't afford not to. I just want to say, it'll be a real honor if chosen to be your candidate and to serve for a school and a community that has given me and my family so very much. And I'm ready to put my experiences to work for you, and I'm asking for your vote in November. Thank you.
Good evening. I'd like to start the closing by thanking all of you who came out to support our political economic studies class, as well as all of our candidates tonight. I'd also like to start by thanking the school board candidates for being so open to come out tonight and share all of their answers with us. Thank you to Rita, our moderator, as well as Mr. Hoffman for coming and speaking tonight. And also thank you to Mr. Shriver and Mrs. Yazel, our teachers, who helped us put this all together so you guys could come out and talk to our candidates tonight. And in the words of Franklin D. Roosevelt, "No one will ever deprive the American people of the right to vote except the American people themselves. The only way they could do this is by not voting. So please register to vote, go out to the polls, and show your opinion this November 8th. Thank you.